have with us today Laura Anderson.
Yes.
She grew up in this area. I'll let her kind of introduce herself, but she's done a lot of work on the history and the genealogy of this particular area. And she can explain a lot why there's so many people, Polish people here. And she'll tell a little bit about that part of the history. So, Laura.
Thank you, everyone, for coming for the whole festival today and for coming in here. I know you're taking time out of your busy schedules. I hope you enjoyed the lunch as much as I did. But to me, that's the highlight in Polka Mass this morning, too. So my name is Laura Anderson, and I got into the genealogy because one day I saw a photograph of my great-grandfather, and he was absolutely, to the eyebrows and eyelashes, a spitting image of my dad. And I had never seen my great-grandpa. And so that got the spark started, and it just went from there. Now, when I found out that my grandma was from St. Paul, and she married my grandpa from Ashton, there went all of the Polish bloodlines together. And so then I kind of became related to everyone around here, and to my knowledge, right? And because I was before that, but by finding that out, I decided to keep a large database of all the research I was doing. And at the time, I was renting microfilms from the LDS Church. I was going to National Archives. I went to Salt Lake City. I can't even remember all the places I went. I used the Nebraska State Historical Society and many people locally here. I just throw something out there and they were kind enough to help me with it. So I gathered a database, and I was doing this just about the time the Polish Heritage Center started. I contacted Phyllis. She was a relation too, and we just kind of talked, and I just donated all of the stuff I had at that time, which I think was about 10,000 names in a database. And now I have not even worked on it full time for several years, but it's at about 22 or 23,000. And those are just out of a few hundred families who settled here. You know, and I'm talking a little bit of sprinkling of some Czech and some German, but it's almost all Polish. So my history, and some of you are going to relate to it, is that my great-grandparents were gone, my grandparents were around, tell me a little bit, not a lot, and I wanted more stories. So one of the things I would love to challenge you all to today is, once a week, would you write a one-page story that won't take you very long, and at the end of a year, put it in a notebook and give it to your kids or your grandkids for Christmas. Okay, include a photo and just stories you remember about growing up, and pass on some of this heritage, some of the things that started in the 1870s here, but came from Poland, and which when we, if we were to all compare those stories, I think we'd find a lot of similarity. So one thing that brought me here today is that in my genealogy, I put a lot of inquiries out on the web through Roots Web, which is an old and almost defunct thing now, and Ancestry. People still contact me, and I won't ever change my email address because of all of this genealogy. And I had two sisters contact me the first time 4 years ago, and they are part of the Kaminsky family from here, and of that Kaminsky family, it was Anton Kaminsky and Josephine Krajewski, and five of their children stayed here, and one daughter moved, and these are all siblings that have come from Missouri, Iowa, and Arizona, and have never been to Ashton before. So they didn't know their grandparents' heritage here. And they all came just for this today. that was part of what got me here, and it's part of why I do this genealogy, is to meet people and learn new things from everyone. So, how did the Polish get here? Some of this is a little bit repetitive if you've heard it before, but in the 1870s, just after the Prussian War ended in 1872, many people were exiting that area. And it was technically West Prussia, but we were still Polish in that area. Much of the people who settled here run in a little line from the city of Poznan around to just south of Gdansk. And I think there's enough online resources now that if you were interested in finding that and you don't know yet where your family was from in Poland, I think I can either point them in the right direction or you can find it. But I think there's enough out there that probably most of you know that by now. Much of our families that settled here either went to Pittsburgh or Chicago. And they were very concentrated. There's still a very Polish part of Pittsburgh, and of course there's a big Polish part of Chicago. There were two brothers who were very instrumental in this, and there's so many details as to how they got the Polish people here. I don't know if I can cover it all today, but John Barsinski was a publisher. He was in Missouri, and he published the only Polish language newspaper in the U.S. at the time. So he could have a lot. We do the recruiting, and he had a lot of reach and a lot of power. And his brother, Vicente Barsinski, was a priest at St. Stanislaus Kostka in Chicago. There was also a St. Stanislaus Kostka in Pittsburgh. And that St. Stan's, to me, is one of the most common church names I know of that's Polish. But they had a lot of reach, and the church was everything. When our folks got here, the church is really what helped them settle, where they could congregate, where they could still speak their language and still have their own customs together. In Pittsburgh, everybody was in the city, and a lot of who had come there were shepherds and people who worked the farms, the agricola. And in Chicago, I don't know it as well and as much, but I think it was a mix of the same. The farmers and the agricola people were a little bit lost in the city. They got discriminated against, and it was hard for them to integrate. What started happening within about 2 years of when, I know my folks came in March of 1873 and went to Pittsburgh, and the part of my grandma's family was already in Chicago about that time. And so this is where the Chicago and Pittsburgh connection keeps coming in to our relatives here. Vicente Barsinski, the priest, would contact the archdiocese in other areas. And eventually what happened, he and John and about three other Polish priests were very adamant about getting churches and schools for the people, for the Polish people. And from that goal, founded the Polish Roman Catholic Union of America, which, if you don't know of that, it's a fraternal, I think more or less now, insurance organization. And they have some records there that you might never have guessed would help you know more about your family. But insurance records certainly will tell you beneficiaries and things like that. So the Polish Roman Catholic Union of America ends up being a peace that is formed at the same time the Barsinskis are trying to pull the Polish people together and settle them in a place that makes sense for them, which was not in the cities. So there was a priest in Pittsburgh by the name of Father Antony Claveter, and he was the first priest at the Farwell Church here. He recruited about 100 families from Pittsburgh, of which there were Kaminskis and Kalkuskis, Augusta Majewski, I can't even name them all, bunch of about 100 families were, I believe it was trains. Somebody asked today, was it wagons and things? I believe it was trains that brought them out here. Because by that time, John Berzinski was a land agent for the railroad, and he was supplying the land for all the people who were coming as farmers. So that's the Pittsburgh part. My family was there for about 5 years, and in the spring of 1878 arrived here. And the Chicago piece is Valenti Barczynski at his parish. He recruited also about 100 families, and they came too. And the town of Ashton was already there. The town of Farwell more or less formed about that time as Posen, or New Posen. And many of you remember, you know that. All the people who are from around here, we've been joking about how the town of Farwell became Farwell. And I said, I thought nobody knows. I thought everybody just kind of has hearsay stories about it. But I don't know. So if anyone here knows, by all means, share it with us and let us in on it. But the post office at New Posen changed to Farwell. But it was very, very much the Polish people who settled it. Ashton had its own newspaper in the 1920s, and if you have never accessed that, that is also a fantastic research tool. I like to particularly read newspapers around the holidays, because like Christmas, because that's when the whole family would come and visit the parents or the grandparents, and you can always find out more members of the family by reading who came to visit. So the Polish Roman Catholic Union of America, the two priests, they have a lot of support from Poland on this. They're recruiting some nuns to come to and help support this. The families arrive here, they get their land grants, they get out, they lived in sod houses. Does anyone have photographs of your grandparents or great-grandparents in their sod houses around here? No one does? I would look for those. They're probably around. Someone in your family may have them. Or if you look at the Polish Heritage Center or either Historical Society in Howard or Sherman County, you might find those. When they got here, they lived in sod houses. They dug into the hill, side of the hill, and made enough room to survive for a year or two or three or four or five until they had everything they needed to get themselves a home. There was an early timber claim around here too, and it was one of the Danish names, I can't remember, Leninger, I think, who had a timber claim and then started supplying a lot of wood to start building houses around here. So as time went on, everybody got settled in more, lots more children here. The church at Farwell was there, and you can also access their baptisms and marriages on my film. I got mine from the Nebraska State Historical Society, but I think by now some of the local places around here, the historical societies or the libraries, may have those too. So if you're looking for older documentation of your own family, those are easy ways to get a copy of a baptism record or marriage. About all that the Church of Posen had when I was researching, so I don't know if the death records are included yet or not. But another great thing that's changed since I started doing my work on this is that everything is getting digitized. And the things that I had to order from the Mormon Church in Salt Lake to send to the Family History Center, wherever I lived at the time, they're digitizing everything, and they say within the next 5 years they'll have everything done. You can access it online for free. There's how-tos on how to find what you might be looking for because you may not know what you're looking for. So they have search things to help you with that. Right now they're digitizing about 1,000 microfilms a day of their records, and they have been the largest single group at any place on earth that has collected and saved a lot of this. So if you're interested in it, direct connection to one of the earliest farms that were settled in Sherman or Howard County here. Do you know anybody who was one of the first generation here? Okay. My family, I like to do the research on women. The men are kind of easy because we use their names. But the women, the maiden names tend to get lost sometimes. The matriarch of the Kalkuski family and the matriarch of the Vyshurskis here were sisters. They were born in the 1828 and 1834. And so a lot of people around here, I'm not even sure, can connect back to that very first generation that was here. They had already had all their children by the time they moved here, so they had large families. And all of those families lived here and intermarried. So every Kalkuski, Kaminsky, Kryaski, Klein, Jaris, Jehorik, Macheski, Bedura, Stobi, everything around here that you can come up with can relate to some of those very first families, and I'm talking specifically to Ashton and Farwell. When we then expand out to Loup City and St. Paul, you get even more. But from what I found, much of the Farwell people were from a very small area in Poland, just north of the city of Poznan, and they knew each other. They came here knowing each other. Those were Smidras and Luka Savage and a lot of those names. Farwell was settled more from the people further east of the city of Posen over by, I can't say the names. Tychew was a big city, but no one was from there. They were from very small parishes around there. They were farmers. They lived in hilly lake country, and that's part of how they got here. The priests who recruited them looked for over a year to find the ideal place to bring these 200 or 250 Polish families, and this is what they chose. Now, it was hard land, but it was good, and I think we all know that our ancestors here were very hard workers and made everything, you know, that we have around here today. Does anybody have any specific questions about any place or names or histories here?
When was Ashton first settled, and what years are we talking about?
In the 1870s, somebody might correct me, it was the 1870s, and it was actually two gentlemen who came from Ashton, Illinois, and started the town of Ashton here. They were some of the first landowners, and I believe the bankers, and they were of the English descent, and when John Barzynski and everyone was doing the recruiting to get the Polish people here, they needed some of that foundation in place too. And so having somewhere that was already a couple of years established was important to them. I was going to say something else about that. We'll come back to me as we answer more questions. So it was the 1870s, it was on a railroad line, that gave the land for them to settle, so it was all connected.
Okay. Yeah. And any of the names Turek or Sidow or Kuczynski, have you run across those names?
Mm-hmm. I have. Like I said, I've got my big database, and I have to look up some of them to remember where they were at. Were those originally in which town? The Loup City, I think. Yes, those are definitely in my database.
And,
which one? Patton. Yes. Yes. One of my clients, we family was bakers, and there's a lot of bakers around here still too. Out of Paplin, the bakers were one of the families who lost 5 children in the diphtheria epidemic around here in the 1890s. So yes, the Paplin, and I think in the past when we've had Polish Fest, we've had trips out there. I know there's a great Facebook group that is supporting the Paplin Church and trying to keep it intact and alive. But if you have time to go to any of the cemeteries in this church and the other churches to see them, that's always worth your time. Always. I'll go get my database and we can look at those. Most of what I have is in the Polish Heritage Center, in the back room where they've got a lot of family histories and computers in there. We can look those up.
I remember growing up and hearing some of the stories about how our families came to this area, but I've never heard it anywhere near the detail you just talked about. I kind of knew the most general level of that, but do you have anything of this available, or is there anything like that published, or
I have one article about this that was in the Independent years ago, and I have a link to it, and I'll give you that. It does go into a little bit more detail about what I just talked about, some more of the exact names of the other priests and things like that. Yeah, I'd be happy to share that with you. Like I said, it was just fun to start, and I had time. I would drop my kids off at school at 8 a.m., and I would go to the library until I picked them up at 3. And for a while, I was lucky enough to get to do this. And so in a pretty decent amount of time, I gathered a lot of data. As we all know, our time constraints with family and work and other things and church and volunteering and everything, we gather a lot of that information very slowly over time. And that's where doing this on the internet is making things happen a little quicker. Digitized is making it quicker. I literally had to put things in the mail, and I'm not that old. I put things in the mail with a written request. Would you look up this one thing at your library for me? Here's a $5 donation, and I'd wait 3 weeks or a month and get a response. And it took years, but every little bit helped. And really, the people in St. Paul and Loup City helped me just incredibly, yeah, because I had never lived in these small towns, but yeah, the outpouring of help and support was really great. And go ahead.
Yeah, I was going to say, I was a librarian in Loup City. We have the Sherman County Times on microfilm, so like if you're looking at history of Ashton, I will bet in 1973-74 there were articles that time, same way Loup City, and I know they used to do stuff with the shops, and I believe if you're looking, if you can read Polish, they may have some of the digitalized newspapers, but they're not just that, they're on microfilm. And they've also got all the grave registers for Sherman County.
Mm-hmm.
Which
I used
is
the school
quite
records.
Valuable if you, because a lot of times there's no headstone, but this will have the burial places.
Agreed. The Sherman County school records, the school census, was really useful to me because my family moved around just a little bit from Ashton to Holt and Atkinson and then to Omaha. And I had no idea when, and that was when a couple of the children sort of dropped off the census, and I said, I don't know what happened to them. And it was the school census that helped me pinpoint quite a lot of that. And if you're interested in finding some of these things, your county clerk, your librarians, the newspapers will have information for you and help you think about things in a new way and something to find that you may not know how to without asking. You know, so we'll always work together. One of my mantras in doing genealogy is sharing it. And I know that there are pros and cons to that. I acknowledge that. There are some reasons why you wouldn't want to share. But I believe if I have it out there, if anything happens to me or my computer, somebody else is going to have it, and I'm helping other families learn something and then go out and do more on your own. I think that's important. It's fun. It's bonding for siblings and spouses and children. There's a lot of good that can come out of this, and I'm afraid as our older generations are disappearing. My dad passed away last summer, and he tried to get into this so much with me, and his health just didn't let him get out a lot. He made one summer trip with me, and we drove everywhere, met people we never met. We didn't know them. I said, hey, we're related. Do you mind if I come visit you? And they then would have an after-church potluck. They invited everybody in the family to come down and meet us. We did that in Grand Island. We did that up in Lynch and O'Neill. And it just snowballs. You really do make new friends, and you're preserving some of this for yourself and for others.
I was watching the History Channel. They said that a lot of Polish immigrants came here and settled in Chicago and Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, because of the iron mills.
Mm-hmm.
And our genealogy that I think I got from you, from Phyllis, her last name is Caston.
Mm-hmm.
So they stayed in Philadelphia for like 4 or 6 years before they actually came out here.
Uh-huh. They were unskilled labor. They needed a job. They would work hard jobs. They did. There's even one or two families that run the coal mines in West Virginia too that ended up out here. You know, so as word spread, yeah, they were from other places too, absolutely. Some in Michigan and some in Wisconsin too. Not to leave anybody out. But they were unskilled, and that's part of what was attractive about coming here was they could get their own land.
You know, some of the information I got from Phyllis, that she gave that from you, that she sent to me. So.
Yeah.
I was going to ask you, did you ever come across anything about Beleshi? That was a Polish settlement there by Ord.
No,
and there's a cemetery there, and great grandfather was buried there.
The Cashlands?
Wardeen.
Or the Wardeen. Yeah.
I get so confused.
Right. That's why I've got it in the computer. I have to look at it because it's so much I can't remember.
But
yeah.
Instead of a stone,
Hannah Persaud, and she married Wardeen, Thomas Wardeen.
Mm-hmm.
So Persaud.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think the name is in my database too.
But I went out there one time and they said instead of a stone, they would plant a tree where you were buried. Well, guess what? The trees are blown over.
Gone. Yeah. So now there's no record where they were.
And then they told about this one person that wasn't Catholic and they passed him over the fence that he didn't get to come in. Handed him over the fence and buried him.
At least they let them in. Well, don't we have stories about all the farm cemeteries around here that young people really are trying to work on and revive, find some headstones, let alone figure out who they are. Rosie Wilson right here is trying to do that on one of her grandma's pieces of property that had some cemetery on it. And you asked me all these detailed questions, and I was like, I don't know.
Well, and what's interesting, you said in 1890, there's a lot of young kids, there is some stones there, and a lot of them died in 1890, and there's, like, my cousin Barbara and I just went and looked the other day, and, you know, they were a year old, or they were 2 years old, or something. There's a lot of children buried. 1890 or 1910, a lot of people died around 1910, and one of the neighbors has said there was, like, a flu epidemic, and I don't know if it was... what it was that killed a lot of people in that time.
I think that diphtheria epidemic was about 200 children between Paplin, Ashton, and Farwell.
And that could be because there are some 18, like right in there.
Yeah,
the
1994, because it was a long-lasting epidemic. It didn't just last for 6 months and go away. It lasted a long time.
Do you
So that's, I mean, that's what I found interesting, looking at the gravestones that aren't there that you can read, is there's a lot of people died the same year. I mean, it was, and they'd be like 50 years old, or they'd be 70 years old, or there was children that died. It's kind of interesting.
I was up here a few years back that way, and they took us up to the cemetery. And they were, each family had a little talk about how they settled in with the people that were buried up there. The most interesting thing was the guy with the vine rods. He could actually go to the graves, and the rods would separate. And he actually let people who were disbelievers actually come in and hold the rods and walk over the graves and the rods. And he says he couldn't, I don't know how many graves he counted that were along the fence line that were small children's graves. And he knew this for a fact, the way the rods and stuff.
Yeah.
They were buried along the fence, but there was no markers or any stuff because of the fire. I guess a few years later after the epidemic went through, the fire went through there and burned down all the wood crosses and stuff. And there's graves that were still unmarked.
Yeah, you're right. You are right. I do remember.
But it was very interesting. I mean, you went to each family and they told about their family histories.
Yeah.
It's pretty interesting.
Yes.
The guy with the defining rods, his name was Skip Meyer. He's from Aurora, not Aurora, but St. Laborde. And he studied under Robert Manley, he's a historian here in Nebraska. And his specialty is the history of the cemeteries and traditions as to why they have certain symbols on cemetery gravestones. And the divining rod demonstration is something that
you're just saying you ever imagined.
A few years ago,
people just believe and think it's actually a trick, but actually, there's the rods. You will walk over the grave, and the rods would actually separate.
Oh,
and that meant there was a
Does it measure that it's been disturbed, or the, what does it? By how far it separates out?
Oh, you can tell if it's involved in the trial.
Sure.
Milwaukee has such an ethnic diversity. It's fantastic there. But yes, there are places like that. You may even find some of that online with no fee.
I
was going to mention the Polish Genealogical Society of America, the PGSA. If you're not a member, look at their website and look at all of their databases and everything they put out. They do a once a year convention, a big convention that you can go to and learn things. They're located in Chicago, and they are also associated with the Polish Roman Catholic Union of America. So they have a lot of database and information between them. I think we've already decided now we have to go to Chicago. And there's the Poznan Project. If you're not familiar with the Poznan Project, a gentleman years back got into this, decided to try and help all us Americans find the marriage, birth, and death records in the Poznan province, which is a significant number of the people around here. And if you go to his website, and I don't remember if you have to be a member or not, I think it's just a register with him, I don't think it's a paid, they may take donations. You can access all the church records that they've been subscribing. Yeah. So that Poznan Project is also a very good one for a database because, I'm talking all of the Snejas Czaporek, everybody who came from there, the Lukasiewicz, goes on and on. They're all there.
We were told that as children growing up at the Catholic Church here in Ashton burned down.
That was horrible.
Is that true? And along with it, all of the birth records and the baptism records. Did that ever happen?
Was that the Farwell?
That was a Farwell church.
The Farwell church,
yeah.
Not the Ashton.
Again, when it, early on, one of the early priests wanted to build a church, which the poor farmers who were in the midst of a depression really didn't support the idea of building an expensive church because they didn't have enough money for that. So speculation is that church burned down because some of the parishioners who were upset with the idea of building the church were the ones that torched it. And I think that even happened twice. And then ultimately, what church there was outside of town got moved into the town of Farwell in about 1925 or so. Then when they moved, there's pictures of that move that are over in the center. When they moved the church, they literally had to cut it in half to be able to move it. So they decided, well, in the meantime, we'll expand it. So they put one half here and one half here, and they added about a third in the middle, so it's long, you know. And it was kind of a community project at the time back in the, when that was put there, because the foundation that the church was put on was from, I think, the old rectory from the rich church. And people in town, they took the used bricks, and mothers, fathers, children, they were all out there chopping on these bricks, cleaning them up to build that foundation. But the church was New Poznan, that's the one you're thinking of.
We had a friend in Ord that is from Farwell, and she walked down the aisle on her wedding on planks between the two churches weren't together yet.
I look forward to that.
I have no idea.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Wow. Why wait for her to finish giving bill?
Can you tell me the last name of the two women you said in the 1820s? Was that, that's kind of who we all come from?
Well, this is interesting, too. Their maiden name was Philbring, which very much sounds more German than any of them. But I get back in that time frame in that area, and I couldn't tell you.
Okay.
What ethnicity person had. But those were the two sisters, and Elizabeth got here, but Caroline didn't survive until she got here. And I don't know when and where she died, but I do feel that if it was here, I would be able to find it somewhere, maybe, somehow. I could be wrong, but I think she died before she got here, so I think it was Pittsburgh. Now we also have a request for everyone who is here. Larry has some family group sheets, and if you don't use these within your genealogy, I started mine based off of these. I would mail them out to people. I'd find one person in each family who would help me and say, would you please help me, you know, learn about my family? And they fill out themselves and their children. And if you would help the Polish Heritage Center out by filling out some new family group sheets, we'll add them to the back room in the genealogical section of the Polish Heritage Center. I know for me, I can absolutely update my kids' data and get, you know, those younger generations who have just married and had kids in the last 10 or 15 years. I'm sure they're looking for some of that. And then if you know some of the older names, dates, and places, that's always welcome. We can match things up and verify.
We have grandchildren you want to.
Yeah, if we would. That would be nice, because when we all get together like this, they're going to come someday. They'll come to the Polish Heritage Center, which will be twice as big as it is now, because they're doing such a good job of preserving all of this. Now, my trust is with them to preserve this for us. It really is. And I don't trust a lot of places that I give that kind of information to. But I think they are a responsible entity that will preserve this and keep it useful for others. So if, when we leave, if you would fill out a family group sheet, especially all these folks who came from Missouri, Arizona, and Iowa. My new Kaminsky cousins have never been to Ashton, and it's high time they did, and got here and enjoyed it. So if you in any other of these rows are related to Kaminsky's, Krajewski's, and then if I look at all the siblings' names, you'll be related.
Now, I was told that by Phyllis Yoda that we have plenty of these sheets.
We can only find
a center. We can only find a few of them. So
if you would kind of share and pass them around, maybe make copies.
To supplement
just return
those,
them to the center and
you can find these on the web. If you just Google family group sheet form, you'll come up with a bunch. Print one out at home, fill it out, and then either bring it over to the Heritage Center or put it in the mail and bring it back. Yes, please do. I apologize.
I'm sorry I don't have more, but
we didn't know we didn't
she's
have
in Poland, and I have no way of finding out what she did with
it. Laura, I have often thought about this. I even asked the question during, I don't know if I've ever asked it before, but it's interesting to me. It always made sense why towns in America were named New Holland or New, New York, any of those. Those made sense, but I wonder, like Ashton, there was Ashton, Illinois, what Ashton meant, what purpose there was for that particular name in Illinois, and then why people had to think about, we're starting a new town, let's call it,
yeah, Ashton. That's why you see towns from the East Coast repeated within migration patterns. When I can go all the way back in my husband's lines to people who served in the French and Indian War, well, if you served in that war, you were granted land right here. And so people who started in Chester County, Pennsylvania, who served in that war, ended up with land in Washington County, Pennsylvania. And then Ohio opened for settlement 20 years later. So those children go, I mean, there are definite patterns. And when you begin to learn the ones that are associated with you, you will see town names repeated as they go, too. And they just are because they're familiar. They say, that's my home. This is now going to be your home. They did that with purpose. Yeah. The New Posen was the name of Farwell. And the Pelplin, which was Paplin, is a name of a town in Poland also. I think we in whatever way we spoke the name here, we ended up calling it Paplin. But the town in Poland, I do believe that it was named for, was Pelplin. And there was people from around here from there too. Yeah, did you get repeated?
So is it possible that if you have relatives in Pennsylvania, because I do have both on both sides of my family, but then some went to Ohio, and then they came here.
With no stops in Indiana or Illinois, just Ohio to here. Mm-hmm. They may have waited for the first wave to come through, to get past the Illinois-Indiana time frame of expansion. Was it Berea, Ohio?
Yeah.
We got Polish people there too. Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. That was another segment that arrived here. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's in the database.
They came and it grew because my grandmother, great-grandmother, came with her sister. Her husband died in Berea, and then she came with her sister. And then she married somebody here.
Yeah.
So then,
yeah. I do have some of that in the database that's over the Old Heritage Center, definitely. And that reminded me of something else about something that's over there. Come back to me.
So is there a way to find, like, our great-grandfather who passed away, great-grandmother came, children, is there a way to find his grave?
there should be. I also used the Archdiocese of Pittsburgh's archives. So I would think in any archdiocese area, they have their archivists, and they are very helpful. They're also very protective of their information. You do have to be relative. There are things, at least at the time, they have to know why you're asking, but they send me information too. So yes, I would think those archives might be start and find out which church, and then some churches have the database available. Just depends on the place. What was the location? Which name?
Cashlin.
Cashlin. Okay.
We have noticed that there are some spelled differently.
Yeah. Were they in Pittsburgh? You said Pennsylvania. You said Philadelphia.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what I heard on TV, that a lot of Polish immigrants came to Philadelphia and Chicago to work in the steel and iron because there was such a concentration already, that that's where they came because they felt more home and they were given jobs.
Yeah.
And like I said, from the research that you did in Phyllis back to me and stuff, they stayed there for, it was either 4 or 6 years before they finally came to Ashton.
Okay. Let me look up a couple other things and see. Because the Cashlins, I think, were from that parish just north of Poznan City. Do you guys know where in Poland they were?
Yeah, I was going to ask you.
Okay. Let's look at that before you guys go and see what you can find. Yeah. How much more time do we have?
10 minutes.
10? Okay. Let's keep going. Anything in particular?
So they didn't change their name. Like, so many people changed their name when they came.
Mm-hmm.
But the Polish people did not.
Some did. The Majewski is the perfect example. It was Majewski. And for some reason, this Nebraska group of that switched to M-A-I-E-F-S-K-I, with the way it sounds when you say it. And so when you see it spelled that way, I just almost always think it's this group. And in fact, the mother of all the Majewskis was my great-great-grandfather's sister. Yeah?
I happen to be a Majewski.
All right.
Well, these guys are both related to
Majewskis.
Which, it's so funny because Norbert Kalkuski grew up here in Ashton and went to the Catholic schooling and everything. And I went to his 90th birthday party. I crashed. And met all his kids, who I'm still in touch with. They're a phenomenal bunch of people. And Norbert, at age 90, was telling me stories about growing up and who was who, and he would give me a vague story. He'd say, you know, I just heard they came when so-and-so was 3 years old. And so I would research it hard and from every direction I could, and I found that he was right. He was right, like, within a year or two. So maybe it wasn't when somebody was three, but it was when they were five. So if you ask the stories of our oldest generation, who is still here, and what they remember, go with it. Assume that it's pretty darn true, and then try and find your facts. Do your research and find the actual the primary sources that really document that and give you the best proof. And some primary sources are going to conflict. They just are, even though they're considered the truest record of the time, a legal record, they can still conflict. The Baker family I talked about, children buried at Paplin, their name was B-E-J-E-R. And that's the Bakers who are still around here today. And the very first records that were around here spelled it B-E-G-G-A-R. And so it did morph and it changed a little bit, and then they become Bakers, and there's a lot of Bakers around here too. And yeah. So you have to be creative with your names sometimes.
Are the Majewskis here? Is your great-grandparents buried here?
Yes.
In Ashton?
Yes.
My grandparents and my dad are buried on that same lot.
Who's your...
My grandfather was Joseph.
That's our great-grandfather.
That's our great-grandfather.
It's one of them.
Joseph? Well, isn't there...
No, Joseph was...
Joseph, I bet, was your grandma's brother.
No, we're... Joe. Or John is our great...
That was your great-grandfather.
John is our great-grandfather. The one that was married to Rosalia, that's our
great-grandparents.
Yes, but my grandpa's buried on that same plot.
Joe, yes. Eric?
Married to Francis. And my dad was Alfred. He's buried there.
Okay.
And then my uncle is Eric, and he's buried there.
And then Eric's there too, right? Is that your uncle?
Yes.
Yeah. We knew Eric.
Our grandmother was Miss Philomena.
The older Philomena.
That's the other thing we all did.
That was a great
family. How funny!
And I can't tell
you. Oh my God, we got two
Philomenas.
There's two.
Martin Vidala stumped me forever, and so did I think there were two Anna Vidalics that stumped me forever. And then everyone is John, Joseph, Anton,
Michael,
and the ladies, Mariana, Paulina, Mariana, Anna, Paulina, Mariana. Gosh, that was hard for me to figure out at first, but I loved it.
Another thing, my sisters did a lot of genealogy in our family, and my grandpa came into Chicago and worked in a packing plant, dumping innards into the railroad cars.
Yeah.
So they did what they had to do.
And what was his name?
Gimbala.
Ah, yes.
And so then he ended up coming to Tarnoff, Nebraska, because he had an aunt there that could sponsor him. Mm-hmm. But my sister's doing the genealogy. He was born in Poland. And sometimes the family would lose a male child, and the next male child got that name.
Yes.
So it was very hard sometimes to follow
that. And unless you had the record of that child who died, you never knew about them, that another later child was named the same name and things like that.
In 1990, when Poland could release their records and they got them out from under communism, then they got a lot of things from Salt Lake City.
Yeah.
Found out where my grandfather was born, and so we went there 8-9 years ago.
Yeah. I'm still envious of everyone who's already made it over to Poland.
Oh, yeah.
I'm going to get there, but I can't wait. And I know the Polish Heritage Center every now and then will sponsor a group. They'll say, "We are going, do you want to come?" Sponsor, but if you stay in touch, if you're a member of the Polish Heritage Center, you'll be notified of things like that too. Maybe we'll all go.
That would be fun.
I really thank you all for coming out today.
Thank you.
Yeah, I appreciate it. And it's so nice to see you here and hear the names. I recognize every name pretty much that you could throw at me, but I just don't know you all, so it really is nice to see you.
We do have a donation jar in the back to help fund the trip that she made out here from Colorado, and will help support her continued work. So if you'd like to contribute to that, there is a jar in the back of the room. I know you wouldn't tell anybody about it, but I will.
You don't have to train it, huh?
Well, I don't know how long we can stay in here, but we can either stay in here or we can go somewhere else more convenient and still chat if you'd like to. I'm not going anywhere yet, so...
I'm going to go ahead and stop the formal part of things. If you want to stay here and chat, that's...